start recording now.
I said start recording.
Now.
I was asked in the early 70s to do installations all over the country. And for the price of the materials and my ticket, I went to these different places and did an artwork. They're like statements of reality that you feel in the conversations that artists have with each other and with the world and with their times.
One thing that these works clearly do is state that the process, the drawing, texture equal form. And it's about drawing, and these ideas have come from really painting ideas, yet they're dimensional. This is one thing I've always been interested in exploring.
Eat Meat is a sand cast bronze, but has a lovely patina from being out in the elements over 30, 40 years.
I think of myself as a painter, probably because I don't use glue. I found my space, so to speak, because I was particularly interested in painterly materials and also form and space and where the gesture could take the material. All of them are drawn with either a bucket or a can. The use of the body, the use of the hand, the use of the movement of the body, dancing and rhythm. I was just very interested in that kind of bodily gesture.
Take it down for real quick.
They're all polyurethane, the same polyurethane used in insulation. I made a couple of pieces in phosphorescence. I had to light them, and they absorbed the light, and then the lights were turned off on a timer. And what happened, because of the flows and the pores and the gravity, what you would see is them coming down and rising again at the same time. I'm very interested in how things change through our reading of the gravity and the form. If a waterfall freezes, how do you really read it? You can read it going up or down, and how do you read it?
This is my sister Jane. She's getting on the motorbike, still motorbike, weight reducing bike. The camera had to be turned sideways so I could get Jane in. She was riding the bike. She's trying to figure out how to turn it on. My father's warning her to hold onto the handlebars. And it started up. Now she wants to turn it off. And she's wondering how to turn it off. Being unplugged. This is my grandmother's house. We're rounding the corner. She lives about a 10-minute ride in a small town called Sulphur, Louisiana. There she is. She looks quite pale to me, and I was very surprised that she was so pale. She's asking me, what am I doing?
I really had a very rich childhood, I think, and also traveled to Greece very early on with my grandmother. Traveled the islands and into the mountains.
my bros live out there, man.
It's pre-classic Greece. They say, even on this island, that there were the beginnings of man, woman, just really early civilization.
Well, what do you do on a weekend?
Nah, man, we go looking for a few fights, you know.
I was born in Lake Charles, Louisiana. I really like the carnival on Lake Pontchartrain and a fun house.
That girl is so big and so fat, it takes four men to hug her and a boxcar to lug her.
Images jumping out, the phosphorescent quality of the images, they seemed very real to me at the time.
This image here?
Good.
Which image?
Okay, let's start recording now.
This image.
Start recording now.
We are recording.
This is a tape he made of a tape she made in her studio.
Louisiana had a whole area of waterways that led to a big lake that then led to the Gulf. So there were all kinds of channels, and I knew them. With other faces. Riding around in a little motor car, being right there on the water. His tape was raw. I had horses.
This tape on screen is raw material. Re-photographing his tape made it her work. Or commenting on it made it her work. Or both. She is heard but never seen. Nothing here has been re-photographed.
It started by an invitation from Anand. Anand Sarabhai would like for you to come to India. And Rauschenberg and Robert Morris are introducing me to you. I visited India the last 35 years. After about 10 years, Anand said to me, Lynda, I have a well here, and I want to cover it. I said, well, I'd like to make a fountain. He said, no, I don't want a fountain. He said, I want a sculpture to cover the well. I made a 15-foot trapezoid wall. I began drawing on this wall. I thought I could draw an elephant when I was 2 or 3 years old. So I began drawing an elephant, never having carved a piece of this scale. I grew up in a brick home, recycled brick. So when I visited here, this kind of reminded me of Louisiana. We have a semi-tropical place there. So brick is very familiar to me. This particular brick is soft, so it was easily carvable. It ended up at one end being very vase-like, and at the other end being kind of elephantine. When I finished, rather than a fountain, I had a planter for a palm tree, so I planted a palm tree. There was another image that I also created after that, a two-headed snake. I thought of it as kind of inside out. People begin to come there and worship. Snakes can take on other forms. A snake could be a knot, and a knot could be the beginning of a life. It was a way of arriving at something else other than a wall around a tree or out into space. A knot is sometimes an implosion, but a knot could also be an explosion of energy. I've done both with the idea of that form. It's embryonic, it grows, it comes about, it extends its arms, legs. The floral aspect has occurred. I was showing these wrapped pieces of gauze. I was beginning to think of the gauze as being the skin and the canvas wrapped in the structure of the wire. And someone said they were like kotexes. And I was insulted, but I realized they were right. They were long and tall. For me, they were kind of ghost images and took the place of the canvas and the paint. And then I started tying them in simple knots. I was thinking of an organic cubism, and I wanted to create a space. And then Stella saw the sparkle knots. He was on the panel.
And I got a Guggenheim for these.
When I was at the Acropolis as a very little girl, I remember being totally caught up with the caryatids because they were female. They had an ice-like quality. When I discovered the polyurethane plastic that looked as glass, I was very pleased that people thought it was glass. And I had an illusion of ice, of frozen water, and I wanted these graces to be a fountain.
We are here to take this lovely little girl, watch what she does, into the box, sweetheart. You know where your head belongs? This way. Look at that. Her head is here. Her feet are here. Ladies and gentlemen, noticing that there is not very much room for the little girl to be in there. Watch what we're doing. Close the little box like so. We take a solid blade. We cut right down between the gazippi and the gazapi. Okay, you can do the other end, doesn't matter. We go down the other end, the gazippi and the gazapi. Then we take another blade and we go between the flippy and the floppy. You gotta know where the flippy is and the floppy. Right down there, we cut off like a super kuiper.
To learn more about art in the 21st century and its educational resources, please visit us online at pbs.org/art21. Art in the 21st Century is available on DVD. The companion book is also available. To order, visit us online at shoppbs.org or call PBS Home Video at 1-800-PLAY-PBS.